mind. Dead kings, many things I can't define. Old Cajun spots, wagons flutter your mind. In the sense of compliments, the color of time.
Who cares what games we choose? Little to win, but nothing to lose.
In the sense of compliments, meaningless mounds. Turn on to them, turn your eyes around.
Look what you saw.
You can do beatniks and politics, nothing is new. A yardstick for lunatics, one point of view.
Who cares what games we choose? Little to win, but nothing to lose.
Incense and Peppermints, one of the most iconic songs from 1967 from a little band called The Strawberry Alarm Clock. Hello, everyone. Wes Britton here for Dave White Presents. And today we're going to be talking about The Strawberry Alarm Clock with one of the original members, keyboard player Mark Weitz. We'll be talking about, well, that particular song and the other things that The Strawberry Alarm Clock did in the 1960s, because they were more than just a one-hit wonder. They were film stars. They were in Jack Nicholson's Psych Out. We have a really cool story for you about Roger Ebert's Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. They were in the very first Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In. They kind of got a second wind a bit when Austin Powers included Incense and Peppermints in Austin Powers from Mike Myers, I mean. And, well, since 2007, we've got all kinds of interesting things to talk about. So let's get to it. Enough of me. Let's bring on keyboard player Mark Weitz. Hi, Mark. Thanks for agreeing to appear on Dave White Presents.
Well, it's a pleasure, and good morning to you, too.
Well, I guess let's go back in time for a little bit, and, well, let's tell listeners about a little band called Sixpence. What was Sixpence all about?
That was a band that actually I auditioned for in 1966. In Glendale, California, which is a suburb outside, let's say 15 minutes from Hollywood, if that gives a geographical location. And I auditioned. They hired me. And shortly thereafter, it was basically an English cover band. In other words, they were doing mostly English rock and playing in teen nightclubs and around Southern California.
I'm guessing you all were teenagers yourselves,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, everybody was 17 and 18 years old. I was probably 19 or 20 at the time then. Being the oldest member of the band, it was kind of interesting. Back in those days, when you were 2 or 3 years older, it was a big deal.
That's true, yeah.
And
those girls were awfully young then.
So a lot of times, you know, once I got to know all the guys in the Sixpence and was accepted into the band, and there was a small personnel change here and there, the lead singer left, our manager had us actually playing at teenage nightclubs, and then we were trying to write some new material. When I got into the band, I came up with this idea. I had a music, basically the music and no lyrics written, and I showed it to the band, and they all liked it. And the song eventually became Incense and Peppermints. So I wrote it on a regular spin-it piano. It just came to me. Just the creative process, how that song evolved, was a long, winding road. But that's how it started. We went in the studio. We recorded it. Our manager got us into Art LeBeau's original sound studio on Sunset Boulevard. Art LeBeau was one of the old guys that that's been around a long time, that produced all those oldies but goodies albums at the time, where you would buy a compilation of
oldies. Sure. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And we went into that studio. They had just got a brand new 8-track machine. Bear in mind that 4-track was the standard of the day,
right,
back in 65, 66. And we recorded the music track to Incense and Peppermints and finished it. And at the time, the band was still called The Sixpence.
Well, wait a minute. Before we go, the lead singer for Incense and Peppermints wasn't even a member of the band, was it?
That is correct. What happened was our producer, Frank Slay, had another band, two writers, John Carter and Tim Gilbert, and the band called The Rainy Days. They had a novelty song called Acapulco Gold. Well, those guys lived in Colorado.
Great title.
Yeah. There's another story about that, but that's for another interview. They lived in Colorado Springs, Colorado, and Frank Slay in Hollywood, our producer, mailed them a copy of a little reel-to-reel tape of Incense and Peppermint's music for them to write some lyrics, because he felt that they had a strong lyric writing background. And they send it back with the lyrics that the present-day Incense and Peppermints ended up being recorded. And what happened was, when he played it for us in his office one day, we went in, we liked the lyrics. We went into the studio to try to put the lyrics. Somebody in the band, all of us actually, tried to sing the song, and we played it back and with the music track, and none of us actually sounded just, you know, right for the part. We got close, but we weren't really hitting the right intonations, and it just didn't sound right. So there was a 15-year-old friend of our manager's that was just starting his own band, named Greg Munford, that was basically sitting on the floor of the recording studio watching the session. And we said, "Hey, Greg, why don't you give it a try?" And Greg got up there, and in his nasal kind of voice, tried singing the lyrics to Incense and Peppermints with the track rolling, and he actually sounded the best on it. So we all looked at each other, shrugged our shoulders, and he says, "Well, why don't we just have Greg sing it?" So Greg sang it, and they edited out one extra verse. We actually had 4 verses in that song, because the song was going way over 3 minutes. And in those days, you never...
Right.
Yeah, the 3-minute limit was kind of the... that was as long as you really wanted a single to go. In fact, most of the singles in those days were in the 2-minute range, somewhere in change. We ended up, not knowing that Incense and Peppermints was going to be climb the charts and become a number one hit across the United States. So we never really worried about, well, Greg sang it, you know, he's not in the band, but he sounds good on it. Incidentally, the Incense and Peppermints was scheduled to be the B-side of our first 45. That we were going to put out under the Strawberry Alarm Clock name, which I'll get into in a moment, how we changed our name. And there was a novelty song I wrote called Birdman of Alcatraz, and I sang it, and actually wrote it in the studio in a very short period of time. I think it took us a half hour to write that song. But what had happened is, of course, things changed. And Incense and Peppermints ended up being the stronger of the two records, and I agreed on that for sure. And we were very excited to get that on the A side. Our manager had a meeting with Uni Records, and Russ Regan at the time was head there of the A&R on Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood, and he liked the song, and we were going to put it out with the name The Sixpence on it. The problem was there was another band with the same name, so we had to change our name so there wouldn't be confusion. So, needless to say, we had one night, we were sitting around trying to come up with a new name, all the members of the band, and what had happened was that the Beatles song Strawberry Fields Forever was one of my favorite Beatles songs at the time, and I kind of borrowed the word strawberry off of that, and then we had to hook it up with a second word and to try to give something that made somewhat of a sense for a name of a rock band or a psychedelic rock band, whatever you want.
Psychedelic, yeah.
At the time, which was a label that we were put on. We never really called ourselves a psychedelic rock band. That was a label we were given. But needless to say, we were having a hard time coming up with hooking up a word, and the room was very quiet. We were kind of we probably spent 2 hours trying to come up with different ideas for the name, and there was an alarm clock in the room that had a second hand that was scraping every time it went around and scraped the face of the clock. It made a little noise, and myself and one of the other members, Lee Freeman, we looked over at the alarm clock, and you know, that little light came on in your head. We go, that's it, Strawberry Alarm Clock. So we talked to Uni Records the next day. They went along with the name. I don't know if they liked it, but they went along with it. And the song was the record was put out as Incense and Peppermints by the Strawberry Alarm Clock, and that song was not easy. It was not an easy road to success. We had taken 6 months on the road all over California, from San Diego up to San Francisco, trying to promote that song to every little tiny radio station, stop in, and they'd give us some airplay on these little 5,000-watt stations, which are very small and only usually cover the area in the close proximity to the town. And we really had to pound the pavement on that song, and finally, eventually, we got very close to Los Angeles, Los Angeles being one of the hardest areas in the United States to get airplay, maybe with the exception of New York and a few other large cities. It was just controlled at the time by a programmer that basically told what radio stations what to play, and what he said, I wouldn't mention his name right now, but that's the way it worked back in those days. So eventually, and I'll try to shorten the story up. Eventually, we got the airplay on KBLA, which was an underground radio station here in Los Angeles, by a disc jockey named Dave Diamond, and he had a request line. We had all our friends call in, and we flooded the lines with requests for Incense of Peppermints, and eventually, from the pressure, I guess, from the other radio station, from KBLA and some of the outside stations in Santa Barbara, KAST and other stations around the Los Angeles area, we started getting some LA airplay, and slowly it started climbing the charts, and we were scheduled to be on a few TV shows and trying to get some more publicity. We started playing some of the clubs in Hollywood, the Hullabaloo Club, which used to be Ciro's. We played there a few times, and some of the other clubs, and we were just had our fingers crossed that the song was slowly climbing the charts, and miraculously it actually climbed to number one, is one of those things where we just were trying to keep up with it all. I mean, we were still relatively young. Most of the guys in the band were still under 20 years old at the time all this was happening. And at the same time, we were also, it was necessary for us to go into the studio. Uni wanted an album follow-up on the record, and of course, we had 2 weeks in the studio to come up with a full album of songs. That means we were writing, recording, and everything in that short period of time, including the vocals. We had a vocal coach, Howard Davis, that was able to get us to sing those lush harmonies that we did. Without him, none of that would have happened. So there was a lot going on in our life, and we were just trying to keep up with it all. We were asked to be on the a tour with the Beach Boys in the Buffalo Springfield. We opened, when you have a number one record and somebody goes on tour, they need an opening band. Well, they chose us, and it was one of the most, I would say, we were very lucky at the time to be on one of the coolest tours that I could think of, opening for the Beach Boys. And, of course, Neil Young and the Buffalo Springfield at the time was gaining a lot of popularity. They had some great songs out, and we were all fans of the Buffalo Springfield and the Beach Boys. We loved, going on tour with them, traveling on their private airplane, and so on and so forth. So it was a great time in my life.
Well, before we go on, let's play a little bit of Birdman of Alcatraz for the folks, because since it was supposed to be the A-side and got knocked out by Incense and Peppermints, many folks may have not heard that song since 1967. So, folks, we'll take a few moments here and just give you a sampling of Mark's song, The Birdman of Alcatraz. Birdman of Alcatraz. Well, before we started playing that, Mark, we were talking about touring. Do you have any interesting tour stories? Because you were running around with some of the high flyers of the time, Neil Young and Brian Wilson and all of them. Any special memories of being with those musicians?
Well, actually, on the Beach Boy tour, which we went on two tours with them. One lasted 6 weeks, which included their private airplane, which was that was amazing in itself. It was a converted DC-6 four-engine turboprop aircraft with they had a living room style section in the front where it was literally like a couch with an end table and a lamp, and you would just kind of And then the back of the plane had like regular